Hello, beautiful tribe. Happy New Year. Happy 2022. I'm going to wish you lots of love, the wisdom for this world, really, because we all need it at this stage. I'm going to... Leon is in the house. Leon has COVID, and he knows we're going to talk about this. Hello, Leon. Hello, Alex. Alex, if you want to come back in half an hour, it's in French. I was saying Happy New Year to everyone. Hello, Wondrous Sound. Hello, Rachel. So nice to have you here too. Today, because obviously it's been 2 years, I myself survived, or at least didn't catch the COVID-19. I did when it was Omicron, or I'm not sure how you pronounce it, in December. And it seems like everybody is getting it. Hi, look at that. Oh, Yann is here as well. So today we talk about COVID-19. We're going to talk about the Ayurvedic perspective. We're going to talk about the way Ayurveda sees the virus, which is, I think, very interesting. The way it propagates and the way it grows within our own bodies. And I'm going to give you some home remedies and a few tips and tricks in terms of diet to not only heal yourself if you already have it, or at least contribute to your healing or a faster healing, but also prevent yourself from being a nice host to this virus. So the first thing I want to say is that obviously we all know that COVID-19 is a respiratory disease. Funnily, and talking about my own experience when I did have it, I actually had none of the respiratory and breathing symptoms, but instead I had terrible aches and pains, they say on the website, you know, on websites or on information, it's part of the symptoms. Terrible, like the fascia, the old back, I couldn't sleep, I couldn't lie down. I mean, it was quite severe, but nothing respiratory. So I'm going to address all these symptoms. If you see me reading sometimes, because I have so much to say in such little times. So yes, we know runny nose, headache, fatigue. Headache is something we can deal with natural remedies in Ayurveda, the fatigue as well, the sore throat, the loss of appetite. It will come back when it will come back. Brain fog, aches and pains, as I said, all of this we can deal with. And at least understand it. So the first thing I want to say is a bit of a reminder for those who don't know. In Ayurveda, the Indian medicine, there are three constitutions. One is Vata, which is made of air and space, and is responsible for all movement in the body. That can be your blood flow, that can be your breathing, that can also be the urine, passing urine, that can also be your stools. I mean, every movement in the body is operated by what we call Vata. The second thing is that Pitta. Pitta is fire. Pitta is responsible of transformation. And Pitta is also responsible of the inflammation that's associated with the disease. And thirdly, we have Kapha. Kapha is in charge of preservation of your health. That's also your immunity. And we know that viruses are only and mainly beatable thanks to our own level of immunity. So the three are involved in something like that. We have, and this is where it's becoming slightly tricky, we have good Kapha and we have bad Kapha. Kapha is the mother, it's the nurturer, it's the humidity in the body. This is where I avoid dryness. This is, as I said, also your immunity, we said that. But the bad Kapha is has properties such as heaviness, immobility, it's sticky, it's gooey. So now if I go into a very concrete example and you're going to understand why I'm talking about this, the phlegm that is in your nose is not just in your nose. COVID attacks the lungs, right? Imagine your lungs as two trees with the bronchioles as branches. And at the end of that, like the branches are thinner and thinner until they are like hair thin line, you know, very thin. So when in normal times, there is humidity inside our nose, which is the perfect and normal thing, and it's actually very welcome, obviously. And when we are sick, it becomes stocky, thick, immobile, and this is why we have a blocked nose. Now, it's not just in your nose, it's everywhere there, and it goes into all the breathing system. So this is what we call kapha toxins, kapha ama in Sanskrit. So this is toxins which have the property of kapha, this heaviness, stickiness, gooiness, immobility. And this is what happens with COVID-19. Vata, who is in charge of all movements, cannot take the toxins out of the body anymore. So what happens is that Pitta, who is in charge of transformation, is going to burn a fire. And Pitta, when I say transformation, it can be the digestive transformation. You eat food, it's digested and transformed by your digestive system, but the liquid's in there. And so kapha, the fire, liquefies things, and those things are going to be able to be expelled and out of the body. In the case of the worst case of COVID-19, this operation is not working. Vata is not moving things anymore. Pitta is creating terrible inflammation and still not being able to move things. Because of what? Because we have what Ayurveda calls toxins. And ama is not really toxin. Ama is, the definition of ama is what is not digested and what is not useful to the body and therefore should be expelled and taken out. So this system is no longer working when we have COVID-19. First conclusion to understand from that is, one, we need to get rid of the existing toxins in our body, and we need to eat and make sure we don't create new toxins. And finally, we want to also control the intensity, if you wish, of the symptoms, which are the inflammatory symptoms. So this is what we're going to do here. We're going to talk about all those things. The first thing I want to mention is the perspective of Ayurveda on what is a virus. I find it extremely different from the allopathy and the debate that's been going on for the last 2 years. I'm not going to go into politics. That would be way too provocative here. But basically, Ayurveda thinks that any virus is a living organism, and that as such, we are supposed to live with it, despite the fact that COVID-19 has killed quite a lot of people. This is created by Mother Earth. I'm actually not sure that was the case, but again, that's political. But anyway, this is a living organism. And as such, we don't want to kill or annihilate it. Instead, we want to create, and this is where it becomes interesting, we want to create an environment which is not going to be hospitable to the virus. The environment is your body. So imagine you actually have a hotel and you want quiet and calm people. You do not want like the party goers, the drinkers, the festive. That's not the atmosphere in this hotel. So you're going to put some food that's vegan. There is no music, it's quite a boring hotel, I give you that. But at least the party goers you don't want to invite are not going to join. That's exactly what we're going to do with our body. I'm not asking you to eat vegan, but I'm going to ask you to create an environment which is hostile or at least not beneficial to the development of the disease. So the virus might have even entered your body, and yet it's not going to be able to develop because you are not a good host. This is brilliant. So how is it that we, how can we not be this good host? Not being a good host is actually not creating an acidic environment within the body. The virus thrives and proliferates and grows in an environment that's acidic. If you remember from your school years, we have a level of acidity in our body. On a scale, this is called the pH, on a scale of 0 to 14, 0 is extremely acidic, and 14 is extremely alkaline. And in the middle, there is the neutral place. So that's between 6.5 and 7.5. This is where we want to be. We want to be there on that scale as much as possible, not just for coronavirus, but in our all existence, really, because that's almost a guarantee of good health. Not only, but it contributes massively. In this case here, if the virus wants acidity, we want to create an environment that's not acidic and not beneficial to promote inflammation and the associated illness which comes with the virus, which brings me to diet. First thing you can do to help yourself is eat slightly differently. I'm gonna tell you the best way is to eat simple food. Simple food equal good digestion. In Ayurveda, everything depends on your digestion. If your digestion works, you are in good health, pretty much. So we're gonna eat stuff like pulses, rice, cooked vegetables. Prefer cooking everything. Don't eat raw food. Fresh food is good. Fresh fruits, why not? Not as a dessert, because you remember we don't want to create toxins. Eating fruit as a dessert creates toxin. It does, because fructose is digested by the body in about 45 minutes, when the rest of your I'm saying hi to all my friends and people I know who have joined today. So and I lost the plot. Yes. So what is it that we want to eat? Simple food, carbs like basmati rice, cooked vegetables, very easy to digest. You can have like soup, broth, these kind of things is going to be easy for the body. And while you don't put all your energy into digesting stuff, you can put this energy in recovering. That's what Ayurveda thinks. That's one thing. But especially we don't want to create this acidic environment. And this is why we're going to eat those simple food. So better let's talk about what not to eat. First of all, spicy foods. Avoid spicy food because they're going to feed the inflammation. Spicy food are mustard. This is tomato as cooked, uncooked, tomato sauce, everything tomato based. This is mustard. This is vinegar. You can have a bit of apple cider vinegar, which is less acidic for the body. You're going to avoid lemon. I mean, lemon, if you look on the internet and you check what is neutral diet, as in non-acidic diet, you will find that supposedly lemon is okay. It is true, because when lemon is eaten and transformed after digestion, it stops being acidic. But for the purpose of what we're doing here, no lemon, no oranges, nothing that contains fire. You can imagine everything that's red and yellow and orange, and pretty much that's going to cover it. So you want to avoid this kind of food. We want to avoid, forgot about that. All meat. Meat creates an acidic environment, fish as well. Alcohol, obviously. Chocolate. Canned and processed foods as well, obviously, and ready-to-eat products. So you eat fresh, you eat simple, you eat easy to digest, rice, cooked veg. It's not a lot of fun. It's like our hotel. It's not a fun hotel, but at least the wrong guests are not coming in. So temporarily, that's what you're going to do. And then what else do I want to say? Remedies. This is the second part of it. Yes. My friend Esmeralda Mustang is mentioning lemon. Yes, no lemon. As I just explained, lemon turns into, after digestion, lemons become alkaline or at least neutral. But while you ingest it, it will create, you can simply replace it with green lemon, as in lime, basically. Lime is very good. That brings me to remedies, coriander water. First of all, the remedies I want to say, you can find them all. If you go up on the link in bio, you will find all the recipes in French and in English. For those who are here in French at 6:30, I'm doing the same thing in French. So if you prefer to come back, you can. Otherwise, as I was saying, all the remedies, home remedies to make and help yourself, you can find in the link in bio up there. So the first one is the coriander water. I'm going to still explain what it is. You take a big glass like this, 200 ml glass. You drop in there 3 teaspoons of coriander seed, slightly crush them, and fill it up with cold water or room temperature water, and let it sit overnight at room temperature, not in the fridge. This is, and when I say water, you put cold water, not hot water. So this is a cold infusion. Coriander water is not advisable on the long run. Don't use it as a tea or a drink for fun. This is really medicine. It has many properties, among others, what it's going to do here. It's going to lower your body temperature. So therefore, it's going to take the inflammation down. So that's very good for all types of inflammation, whatever it is. So coriander water, you can have 1 to 2 glasses, maybe 3, depending on your symptoms and the severity of the symptoms. It's also going to help you not only with the fever, but it's going to help you with the headaches. Headaches in Ayurveda are migraine is fire. It's too much pitta again. So that's also going to help you a lot. It did help me massively. I didn't have to take ibuprofen and all these painkillers. And I'm going to have a note on painkillers as well, just in a minute towards the end there. And why it's not so good to take them when you're trying to boost your immunity. So coriander water, 1 to 2 glasses in the morning, maybe 3. Don't drink it after 3 p.m. because it's very, or 4 p.m. because it is diuretic, and it will probably wake you up at night to have a wee. So we want to avoid that. We want you to sleep very well. The second remedy I wanted to share was the blackened coconut. Many of the advantages, it helps with the respiratory system too. You take, if you find one, a fresh coconut, slice it, pick it with a fork, and pass it over the open fire. Like 1 to 3 minutes, depending. And you pass the flesh over the fire till the white flesh becomes a bit like brownish. And you eat the flesh like this. That's a very good remedy for this. The third one is another tea and recipe you can find in the blog. I mentioned, again, I'm repeating, the link is above in bio. Lime, ginger, and honey tea, very good for you. Or lime, ginger, and honey, perfect. Take it like 2, even up to 4 times a day, I want to say. That helps the digestive system, which is involved in all illnesses in Ayurveda. And it will also, ginger is very burning, but not inflammatory. Honey has the same properties. So it will help liquefy and clear the pathways, the breathing pathways. So those are small remedies. They are good for prevention, and they are good if you're sick, both of them. In terms of teas, there are very good ones. Tulsi is a natural, Tulsi tea, T-U-L-S-I, is an antiviral tea, antibacterial, antimicrobial tea. Hello, Nora. And Tulsi tea is very good for this kind of ailment. It's also very good for asthma, for example, for all breathing issues. So you might want to try the Tulsi. I know that Puka, if you don't know what Tulsi, it's translated as holy basil. And I know that the brand Puka does a Tulsi tea, so you can find it there. Two spices which are recommended in your food and as teas as well, clove and cinnamon. Clove and cinnamon you can put in hot water. You put it in water rather, in a pan, in a pot, and take it to the boil and then sip it and drink that. This is also very good for all respiratory issues. That will help a lot. I did some when I was down with COVID, and that helped me actually a lot. That and coriander water for my headaches were brilliant. I want to mention something about vitamins and minerals. I hear very often people telling me, oh, I take zinc, I take iron or copper or whatever. And actually, it's better if you're going to take vitamin and minerals. This is very advisable in the case of any virus. All of the viruses are actually, viruses are not going to be healed with antibiotics and painkillers. I think we all know that, but I should mention it. If your doctor has prescribed antibiotics while you have corona, you probably have other infectious and inflammatory diseases which are related to the virus. They are not the virus. And to avoid complication, the doctor is giving you antibiotics. This is really arguable because antibiotics will also kill your immunity. So it really depends on antibiotics. I think that for people who are severely diseased with corona disease, who am I to say differently? But I'm just saying it's a very much a difference in terms of dose and level. Do not take, obviously, antibiotics if you have corona, unless your doctor has prescribed it. The second thing is, to go back to the minerals, when you have like, and I had hepatitis B, which is a terrible virus, Epstein-Barr, which is the, we call it the illness of the kissing illness or something, whatever. There are very serious diseases, viruses. And again, vitamin and minerals is probably what's going to also help boost your immune system. The only thing is that what I want to say first, do not take one or two. Go and find a complex that has like 15 to 20 minerals. Usually the vitamins are in there. By default, they always put like 6 or 7 vitamins. That's fine. But choose one that has at least 15, 20 minerals. And do a course of only 2 weeks. Do not take that forever and ever, but only 2 weeks. The body is going to take what it needs and reject what it doesn't. So because you don't know unless you had a blood test, if you miss iron or copper or whatever, but having all these minerals is a booster to the immune system. So that's also a good idea. That's not an Ayurvedic thing. This is an allopathic thing. In Ayurveda, there are two medicines which are strong antivirals, Pitta Ahara. If Pitta Ahara, you can PM me and I can send you this by post if you wanted to. Otherwise, on the internet, you might find something called Mangista. M-A-N-G-I-S-T-H-A. M-A-N-G-I-S-T-H-A, Mangista. This is a strong antiviral. This is plant-based, has no secondary or collateral damage effect kind of thing. But you can use those, take 1 500 milligram a day, even as prevention if you're above 70 or if you have diabetes or you're afraid, you can actually take those antiviral, not forever, just for 10 days, 2 weeks. And finally, I just wanted to make a note about paracetamol and painkillers in general. They lower your immune system. They do. We know that. It's proven. It's not a good idea. So again, question of level. For example, I had COVID. I was so much in pain from my back. I couldn't sleep. I would wake up at night at 3 a.m. They call it aches and pain, but let me tell you, it was not the flu from the aches and pains from the flu. It was hardcore. Everybody, everywhere. My back felt like I was a global inflammation to the point that I could not lie down, could not sleep, could not sit down. So there has been a point where I took, in the course of 7 days, I took two paracetamol, I think, to help me go to sleep. And the reason why I said I did that is because the pain was so long, nonstop, and for days. What happens is like a nervous system sends to your brain signals that there is a stress. Pain becomes a stress. And as a result, the brain sends back the message to stay stiff, to kind of contract. It's almost like it has the opposite effect. I need to relax my muscles. And actually, the pain is even more contractive. And therefore, at some point, taking a paracetamol or two, if the headache is unbearable, if the pain is ongoing, just do it because, again, that if that helps you relax, this is what you want to achieve. Nora says, ginger, a stick of cinnamon, 3 dates, one lemon and boil it together, then strain and drink with honey. Very good. That's brilliant. Ginger, indeed. As I said, it's pitta, so it's going to help liquefy and remove the phlegm, but it's not going to promote the inflammation unless you abuse it. Stick of cinnamon, exactly. Cinnamon is brilliant for the respiratory system. 3 dates. Dates are fantastic. Dates are great for potassium, for many minerals, but it's also a very good, what we call a rejuvenator. It helps recreate extremely good quality tissues. So while you are in remission, while you're fighting the disease, a date a day, or 3 dates in the recipe given by Nora here in the comments, is a very good idea. A lemon, so I use, as I explained earlier, better use a lime rather than lemon, but lemon will do, it's not the end of the world, in small quantities, lime is better. Boil and add honey. And honey has the same properties kind of ginger, which is like it's pitta, it's heating, it's antibacterial as well, by the way, antiviral to some extent. And so honey is a very good idea too. Thank you, Nora. So guys, I don't know if anybody has a question, or I just want to say all these advices and the understanding of the disease, I hope help you understand the most important is like eating light and clean, because while you do, you don't create toxins. Second off, how do we get rid of the existing toxin, the coriander water and the recipe, as I said, in bio link, you can find it. The coriander water is going to help you take the inflammation down, etc., etc. And then, so we want to take the toxins down and the inflammation, therefore the effect of the symptom down. I wish you all to stay safe, healthy. Probably take a test before you go see a group of friends, because I think that this is the way. Leon is still here. Leon is down with COVID. He's listened to the whole thing. I hope that helps you, Leon. And I wish you a very good evening. Thank you, Rachel, as well, for your comments. Beautiful. I'm glad if it's valuable. Share it with your friend. Everybody has Omicron right now. So share it. If those small things can help you out, let's spread it. Much love to all of you. Thank you so much. And we'll see each other for another Tribe Talk very soon, I hope. Take care.